snow blue is to be cool, like I said. So, so let me start over. There have been over 20 Captain Marvels, if you include obscure alternate histories and that one panel joke and that issue of what if or whatever. But we're just going to talk on the ones that lead up to two of them. And that is the ones that are in the two movies that came out. Captain Marvel, Carol Danvers, in the Marvel Comics movie that just came out this past week on National Women's Day. And the one that people think is named Shazam. There is a character named Shazam in a movie by that title that's coming out in a month. And I'll tell you what that's all about. Here's what it's all about. Okay, so 14 billion years ago, everything was in a hot, dense state, and then, let's fast forward about 13.8 billion years. All right, printing press, publishing, magazines, newspapers, newspaper comic strips get put into booklets that are given away as premiums, then Max Gaines says, let's put a 10-cent sticker on it and see if that sells, it sells. And then, depending upon whose grand daughter, you believe, either Major Malcolm Wheeler Nicholson helped Siegel and Shuster finalize their creation of Superman, or he didn't. Like I said, depends upon whose granddaughter you believe. But 1938, Action Comics number one, Superman is a big hit. He is generally acknowledged as the first superhero because he's got a secret identity and superpowers and fights for right and justice. And next thing you know, there's more superheroes out there. Now, let me step back just a few decades. Who's ever heard of Captain Billy's Whiz Bang? Who's ever seen the musical Music Man? All right, do you remember when Professor Harold Hill says, do your children memorize jokes from Captain Billy's Whiz Bang? Well, that was an anachronism because that movie was set in 1911, and Captain Billy's Whiz Bang was a magazine that was started in 1919 by Wilford H. Fawcett, a U.S. Army captain retired from World War I, as a giveaway to, as something he wanted to give to his veteran friends in hospitals to make them feel better, but it became a big hit in newsstands, and that started the Fawcett Publications publishing empire. They would do magazines like Mechanics Illustrated and Woman's Day and other things that you probably actually heard of. Move forward a few decades, his son, Roscoe Fawcett, noticed the popularity of Superman and superheroes and also noticed that 10 to 12 year old boys were the dominant demographic of people who bought Superman comics. So, he got a couple of his staffers, Bill Parker, a writer, Charles Clarence Beck, an artist, and said, give me a Superman, but make his alter ego a 10 to 12 year old boy instead of a grown man. And first Bill Parker thought of a team of superheroes, which would have been the first ever superhero team coming out in 1939. But the editor said, nah, we don't need it, it's too complicated, we'll keep it simple. So he came up with this idea, and here was the idea. And it was drawn into a story by C.C. Beck. There's young Billy Batson, an orphan newsboy, in the rain, at night, in front of a subway entrance. And a stranger in a dark coat and a tall hat comes up and says, why aren't you home in bed, son? I'm an orphan. I sleep in the subway. I have no home. It's warm in there. Come with me. And for the first and last time in history that this was ever a good idea, Billy Batson followed him down the stairs into a forgotten subway tunnel. This strange subway car with cabalistic symbols all over it shows up. They get in. It travels. It stops. It lets them out in a strange cavern. There's an entrance to a long cave-type thing. Tunnel. There you go. And on one side of the tunnel are seven statues of the seven deadly enemies of man. Not the seven sins of antiquity. This was more for a family-friendly audience. For instance, you didn't have lust and sloth. You had injustice and laziness, for instance. But they were there, these statues. And at the end of the statue was an old man, long white beard, long white hair, a long robe. He had a globe on one side of his throne, two books on the other, a flame and a brazier, and above them, a block of granite held by a single thread. He said, come, Billy Batson, approach, come closer, words like that. You know my name? I know everything, for I am
Shazam!
Crack through, and a blast of lightning reveals these names on the wall with the powers that they represent.
While the camera person changed batteries, here's what he missed. The six ancient gods and heroes had each granted the wizard powers. Solomon, wisdom. Hercules, strength. Atlas, stamina. Zeus, power. Achilles, courage. Mercury, speed. And the first letters of their names spelled out the name of the wizard, Shazam! By speaking the wizard's name, Billy Batson could become the superhero Captain Thunder! But the editors did not like the name, so it was changed to Captain Marvel. This new hero proved to be more popular than Superman, even having a motion picture serial before any other superhero, and spinning off a family of heroes including Captain Marvel Jr., Mary Marvel, Uncle Marvel, the three Lieutenant Marvels, and Hoppy the Marvel Bunny. The company known today as DC took note and sued, claiming copyright infringement, that Captain Marvel was too much like Superman, and that they were copying Superman's stories and pictures. Fawcett defended by saying how different Captain Marvel was from Superman, and besides, the Superman newspaper strips did not have the correct copyright notices on them. The court initially ruled that Captain Marvel was not an imitation of Superman, but that Superman's stories had been copied. However, the improper copyright notices on the newspaper strips did constitute abandonment. DC appealed, and Judge Learned Hand noted the following.
What had happened in the trial was that several Fawcett staffers had said, yes, they gave me a Superman comic and told me to copy it and put Captain Marvel in the story. And several others were like, no, what are you talking about? We didn't do that, but the court went with the copying. The court believed that copying. You could take a look at pictures. There is a stack of comic books with rubber stamps on the covers saying evidence of a picture of Superman tearing up a railroad track right next to a later image of Captain Marvel tearing up a railroad track. However, it also went the other way. Here's a picture of Captain Marvel riding on an artillery shell. Here's a picture of Superman riding on a bomb. So who's copying whom? But Learned Hand said that. Learned Hand went with the you can't copy a character thing. Yeah, you can't say that copying a character unless you pretend it's a character is copyright. But I'm looking at these pictures. It's pretty obvious someone's copying pictures, someone's copying stories, and there's no evidence that DC did not come out and say, we're abandoning our copyright. No, they didn't. It was an accident, so those 160 individual strips are public domain. You could find those strips, put them on a t-shirt, put them on a stained glass window. No one can do anything about it. That's why the Fleischer cartoons are available in so many different editions, because the Fleischer cartoons were not copyrighted. The Fleischer Superman cartoons, if you don't know what I'm talking about, look it up. So, therefore, what you have to do in order to figure out damages is take every Superman comic that was copied by a Captain Marvel comic and look at them and come to some agreement as to how much damage was done by copying that story. All right, now the original case was filed in 1941. By now, it didn't come to court until like 47 or 48, you can look it up. This decision was handed down in 1951. Now, I would ask what happened to superheroes all this time, but we don't have time to go over it. I'll tell you, superheroes were really big in World War II, but declined in popularity afterwards because there were no more Nazis to fight. So, there were war comics and horror comics and crime and teen and funny animals and romance, and that's what the market was, but it was still a lot smaller because there was a lot of concern that comic books are bad for kids. What's his name? Dr. Wortham was just a few months away from publishing his Seduction of the Innocent, which basically accused, you know, there's an entire row with nobody sitting in it right there. Come on down, you know you love me. All right, they were in their costume contest. Give them a round of applause over there. Don't they look awesome? All right, that's Queen Ranger in the original Marvel Comics first Captain Marvel second costume. We'll get to that. So, long story short, Fawcett Publications decided, hey, we're losing money on our comics anyway, let's just settle. DC, here's $400,000. Will you stop suing us if we stop publishing Captain Marvel? And DC said yes, and there it is. And no, they did not sell the Captain Marvel to DC at that point. No, they did not go into bankruptcy. No, they didn't. Fawcett did not go into receivership. No, Fawcett did not shut down. No, DC did not get Captain Marvel as a result of the lawsuit. These are all things that you will find on the clickbait press and in YouTube channels, and every single one of those things is wrong. And that's why I'm here to teach this lecture. So what is true is exactly what I said. Fawcett shut down its comic book division and continued publishing Mechanics Illustrated and Woman's Day and the dozen or two dozen or so other magazines. They got into paperbacks. I think they even did records at some point. They did publish one comic book later called Dennis the Menace for about 20 or 30 years. But that was it. Fawcett continued to be successful until they sold themselves out to CBS Publishing for millions of dollars in 1979. So, why are there any other Captain Marvels in the universe? Well,
and lecture cliffhanger to find out what happens next in the history of the many Captain Marvels, specifically leading up to and about the one who's in the movie that just came out a few days ago. Click on that video you see in this screen that will appear a few days after this video is posted. If you're enjoying it, then be sure to click that like button. Hey, let people know about it by sharing it. Comment, what do you think about this history so far? Do you know something that I don't? And put that subscribe button on, because you never know what is going to come out about another Captain Marvel next.